Welcome to King's Chapel in this season of Eastertide, the 6 weeks after Easter, when 2,000 years ago, a young church tried to figure out who was the man Jesus and what did he want life to be like for all of us, and how could he still seem to be with them after Easter, even though he died? We try to figure out all of that too. Today, our minister, David Waters, will talk about deep joy, the joy that Jesus felt while alive and the joy that Jesus wanted us to experience in this life, something better than being happy, something that sustains you and me, even when times are tough. So it is that we greet you with deep joy. Grateful that you have joined us, grateful for Heiner Christensen, our music director, and for our choir. Grateful for all the leaders of this church and our gospel reader today, Kathy Price. Dear friends, you are always welcome at King's Chapel. We're grateful for you.
Whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at King's Chapel. Believer or doubter, seeker or skeptic, we are all on this journey together.
Jesus said to his disciples, "My peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. In whatever way you are able, now let us share the sign of Christ's peace with one another. Peace be with you. Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare thou those, O God, who confess their faults. Restore thou those who are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto humankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
Hear the words of God's promise. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, let us take heart. God will have mercy upon us, being penitent, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life. Now, as Christ has taught us, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God,
be honor and glory through Jesus Christ forever and ever.
Amen. Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
The gospel reading appointed for today is from John, chapter 15, verses 9 to 17. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you, so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another." Here ends the lesson.
Let us pray. Loving God, as you brought joy to Sarah, who laughed in disbelief, and comfort to Hagar, who cried out in anguish, as you blessed our foremothers, so we ask you to bless those mothers through whom you gave us being, those through whom you sustain us in becoming. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. Amen. My dear friends, as we arrive at this sixth Sunday of Easter to hear Jesus speak to us of love and joy, as we arrive at this second Sunday of May to honor our mothers and grandmothers, I'll ask you to abide a moment more with me in prayer, inspired by the words of the Reverend Hannah Carden. We pray for mothers who are struggling and for those filled with incandescent joy, for mothers who are remembering children who have died and pregnancies that miscarried, for mothers who decided other parents were the best choice for their babies, and for the mothers who adopted those children and loved them fiercely, for those experiencing frustration or desperation in infertility, for those who knew they never wanted children and the ways they've contributed to our shared world, for those who mothered colleagues, mentees, neighborhood kids, and anyone who needed it, for those remembering moms no longer with us, for those moving forward from mothers who didn't show love or who hurt those they should have cared for. For all these, we pray, as we honor the unyielding love and care for others we call motherhood, wherever we have found it, and in whatever ways we have found to cultivate it within ourselves. Amen. My dear friends, if we're tempted to think of Mother's Day as a secular intrusion in our sacred space, we would do well to recall the first Mother's Day, celebrated in 1908 at a Methodist church in Grafton, West Virginia, to honor Ann Reeves Jarvis, a peace activist who had cared for wounded soldiers on both sides of the Civil War. You see, West Virginia itself was born of the Civil War, splitting from Confederate Virginia to remain loyal to the Union. And so it was that years after she'd formed Mother's Day work clubs to educate and assist families, distribute medicines, and improve public health, it was in the crucible, amid the horror of war, that Jarvis began shifting the focus of her clubs to the care and nursing of wounded soldiers from both sides of the war. When the war ended, the work clubs became friendship clubs. Mother Jarvis dedicated herself to the work of healing and reconciliation. She died on May 9th, 1905, and 3 years later, her daughter succeeded in realizing Mother Jarvis's dream of a day to honor mothers and the work of motherhood, of love and friendship, that work to which Ann Jarvis devoted herself. And isn't that the very love and friendship that Jesus urges us toward in John's Gospel? A love that flows from Creator to Redeemer to each one of us. As I have been loved, says Jesus, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. Love one another as I have loved you. A tall order, we might think. How are we to love as Jesus loved? How indeed are we to love as Mother Jarvis loved? But before we despair, let's remember. Wasn't it just last week that our own joy helped us understand a complicated or completed love that thrusts out fear? Let's take heart then and turn to another minister beloved of this community. The great surmise, says Carl Scoville, is simply this. At the heart of all creation lies a good intent, a purposeful goodness, from which we come, by which we live our fullest, and to which we shall at last return. And this is the supreme reality of our lives. This goodness is ultimate,
not fate nor freedom, not mystery, energy, order, or finitude, but this good intent in creation is our source, our center, and our destiny. And with everything else we know in life about the strategies and schedules and technology and tasks, with all we must know of freedom, fate, and finitude, of energy and order and mystery, we must know this first of all. Ready? The love from which we were born, which bears us now, and which will receive us at the end. We must know of that love. This, my dear friends, is the love in which our Lord and brother Jesus would have us abide. This is the love which flows from Mother God to animate creation, all of creation. The love in which we are invited to live and breathe and have our very being. Our work on earth, Carl tells us, is to explore, enjoy, and share this goodness, to know it without reserve or hesitation. Do you see, he asks, how this great surmise stands all our logic and morality on its head? Neither duty, nor suffering, nor progress, nor conflict, not even survival, is the aim of life, says Carl. Oh, we might ask, because those things seem pretty significant. But no. It turns out the Palestinian Jew and the Boston Unitarian have the same answer to what lies at the center. And that is joy. Why has Jesus said these things to us? That his joy might be in us, and that our joy might be complete. And what does this joy look like? A century after Mother Jarvis, another activist, Rebecca Solnit, speaks to us of this very joy. Not ease, not mere happiness, but rather a joy passionate and deep. An insurrectionary joy. Solnit describes the responses she found to disaster. What startled me, she says, about the response to disaster was not the virtue, since virtue is often the result of diligence and dutifulness, but the passionate joy that shone out from accounts by people who had barely survived, those people who had lost everything, who were living in rubble or ruins. Those people had found agency, meaning, community, immediacy, all of this they had found in their work together with other survivors. This is a revolutionary view of human nature and a revelation that we can pursue our ideals not out of diligence, but because when they are realized, there's joy. And joy itself is an insurrectionary force against the dreariness and dullness and isolation of everyday life. Thus says the historian activist, having surveyed a scene in the 21st century, not so different from the one that confronted the public health activist in the 19th century. Rebecca Solnit illustrates for us, she really illuminates for us, the love and joy at work in Anne Reeves Jarvis. How does the great surmise stand all our logic and morality on its head? By insisting on love not as a condition to be aspired to or a standard to be achieved, but rather a gift to be shared. This is the message of our brothers and sisters of the Lewis D. Brown Peace Institute, who this very day march virtually to raise funds and awareness for their work to share love in the face of violence, to share love in the face of a broken world, to do the work of healing and reconciliation. Like Mother Jarvis before her, Tina Cherry, the Institute's founder and director, has answered the prophet's call to step into the breach, to do the work of repair. In their work with families of murder victims, in their work with the formerly incarcerated, in their modeling of unyielding love and care for others, our community action partner reveals the miracle of the divine economy of abundance. Assume welcome, they say. Give welcome. Assume love. give love. And there will be enough. In fact, there will be more than enough. Dear friends, the world chatters endlessly about strategies and schedules, technologies and tasks, bids us look no further than our own cleverness and ingenuity, goads us to put our talents to the work of snatching that piece of the pie that's ours before it disappears. Jesus, on the other hand, appears to us on the eve of his journey to Calvary, and he says, "No, my friends, you were made for so much more than that. From love you were formed, and to love you shall return. Peace, be still, see, just see if you can for a moment lay down your anxieties and ambitions, your turmoil and your tumult, and just abide with me in love. In this boundless, abundant love. Can you feel it? Go ahead, explore it, enjoy it, and then share it. Share it and see how it's never exhausted. Share it and kindle in yourselves that spark of the divine, which is ultimate goodness and joy. We need not be perfect, dear friends. We are but ordinary people, though we be called to extraordinary work. In fact, as our own dear Joy said to me just last week, we are enough. And it is enough that we are beloved of God. You'll have to forgive me, but here I smile to think that here in this Unitarian church, it's a Trinity of Marys that occurs to me. My own mother, my own mom, Mary, who models friendship with Jesus in her prayerfulness, in her patience, and her powerful, beautiful grace. Mary the Magdalene, who, racing from that empty tomb to tell of what she'd seen, mothered the church into being. And Mary, the mother of Jesus, whose Magnificat we heard near the beginning of our service. Well, in a few moments, we'll listen to our soloist, Emily Bieber Harris. She'll sing of Mary, an ordinary young woman from a backwater town who dared to trust in love and abundance, who would be called full of grace, the glory of Jerusalem, the joy of Israel. Let us take heart then, dear friends, not burdened by our past, but buoyed by the promise of abundance. Let us pray for grace, inspired by the words of Sarah Bessie. Mother God, gather us as a hen gathers her chicks, and give us the grace to remember that you hold the whole world in your hand, in your kind, capable, wise hands, including us. May we learn to sit with you in silence and know that it is enough to know you and be known by you and know ourselves, fully human, fully yours, fully held, and fully loved. Grant us the grace to tell you the truth of our lives and of this world, and to listen to the truth you speak back to us, the truth of our belovedness, of your justice, of your faithfulness, of love. And give us the grace finally to say, let it be so. Let it be in me. Let it be in us. My dear friends, may it ever be so.
Thank you.
Let us say together the Collect for Grace. O Lord, our heavenly Creator, almighty and everlasting God, who hast safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by thy governance, to do always that which is righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. O God, the creator and preserver of all humankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of thy people, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. More especially, we pray for the good estate of thy holy church, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians and all those who seek thee by any other name may be held together in the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy goodness all those who are in any way afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate, and especially thy servants, Elizabeth Thompson, Wadad Ayad, Daniel Worth, Clark Allen, D. Clark, Louise Berube, Robert Gupton, Trevor Pennock, Carl Henning, Joseph, Jim, Jane, Lynn, Douglas Kalenda. We pray for all those affected by COVID-19, for all who have died and those who mourn them, for all who are sick and those who are caring for them. We pray for our partner church in Transylvania amidst this pandemic, that our 100 years of partnership may remain strong in both word and deed. We pray for those suffering racial injustice and violence, and for all those engaged in the long, hard work of equity and justice for all peoples. We pray for those suffering the effects of a changing climate around the world, for those struggling with unemployment, economic devastation, and the prospect of eviction, wondering if anyone cares. And we pray for those whom we hold up to thee now in silent prayer. May it please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we humbly ask as disciples of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please join with me in the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for thine inestimable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we may show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we ascribe unto thee all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Almighty God, who hast given us grace at this time, with one accord, to make our common supplications unto thee, and hast promised by thy beloved Son that where two or three are gathered together in his name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the petitions and desires of thy servants as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Amen. Please remain with us at the end of this service to see our announcements of upcoming events at King's Chapel. We hope you'll join and be part of this vibrant community. A particular note, next Sunday is our annual meeting, which will be held at noon by Zoom. It's a chance for us to elect our leaders, hear their reports, and talk about our future. As a church that has congregational governance, every person who is a member has an equal vote. There's no hierarchy that makes decisions. You do. And we need a quorum of 50 on May 16th. Those who are not members, yet at least, feel free to observe us in action that day. And if intrigued, please join us 2 days later for an informational meeting on Tuesday, May 18 at 5 p.m. about what being a member entails. Contact me or David for more details. We'll welcome new members here at King's Chapel on Sunday, June 13th, when we celebrate our 335th birthday. Please also sign up for our weekly e-newsletter on our website. It helps you learn the full breadth of our life together, spiritual and musical and historical and fun.
O God of being and becoming, from age to age you gather a people to yourself that from east to west we might travel in the way of Jesus. Strengthen in faith and love your pilgrim church on earth. Send down the Holy Spirit upon us like the dewfall, that we might go forth in peace, our hearts singing gladness to the living God, our lives bearing witness to the simple truth that God is love. Amen. Thank you.